see you. Well, welcome to Grace Bible Church this morning. We were having our first service, and I said, you know, it's always hard for me to do the service directly following Christmas because I'm still kind of hanging in. I don't want to let Christmas go, you know, like just be done with it. And at the same time, I'm wanting to embrace the new year and a new start and all the things. And Nick's going to cover a little bit of that today, I think. And I'm going to go ahead and do a couple of Christmas songs mixed in with good songs for the new year. And I just invite you to sing if you're at home on the YouTube or if you're sitting here, whichever it is. Go ahead, and I know you sound a little muffly when you sing with your mask on, but it's okay. I can hear you. So let's go ahead and do a little bit here. All right. Checking to make sure I had that going here. Okay, yeah. All right. Service. Father, we thank you. We praise you, Lord, for bringing us here this morning. And for those that are watching via the internet, I just thank you for them. I pray that you've all had you just bless us all, Lord, with a sense of your peace and your Holy Spirit, Father. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's go ahead and do one more song and then catch you up on some things. This is the day that you have made. Whatever comes, I won't complain. All my hope is in your name, and all your joy awaits my praise. Oh, yeah, I give thanks for all you have done. I will sing of your mercy and your love. Your love is unfailing. Lord, I am grateful. When I was down, you brought me out and set my feet on higher ground. So here I stand. Give thanks for all you have done. Okay. Nick, why don't you come up here and we'll go ahead and share these announcements together. We got a bunch of them, but we got them on the screen. That weren't me. Pretty sure. My ears are clean now. Got a little hole there. Well, I'm going to go ahead and do the first part. We've got a lot of little things that every week we'd just love for you to pass along to your friends or do yourself. And one of them would be that if you have a bulletin, if you got a bulletin coming in, or if you didn't, I know we'll give you an opportunity in a minute to raise your hand. We'll get one to you. But we have those little communication forms on the inside of the bulletin, and that gives you an opportunity to just say you were here, put your name, put your email, whatever. Make sure we do have your email because we're trying to be sensitive and let people know if we have any outbreaks or cases, anything new that we know about, or even just information to do with the COVID situation. But also, you'll notice on that communication form, there's another most important thing of all, is that we have a prayer request spot. And we take care of those every Tuesday morning. Anybody's invited to come if you want to come pray with us, if you're available and you just want to come lift up your church family to the Lord. We meet every Tuesday morning at 9 o'clock. And we just sit out in the lobby around a table and we have them all printed out. And it gets to your heart sometimes, but the things are going on. So I also would request that if you put some prayer requests, that if you get a praise or an answer to that prayer, let us know. You know, we'd love to have that too, because sometimes it's really like, wow, it's a lot of stuff going on with people right now. You want to take one of them?
I do.
Go back for me. You got your mic on?
Is this me? Am I on now? Okay, testing. One, two. One, two. All right. Do I have the slide?
Well, I was going to YouTube it. And
YouTube, yeah. So we have a YouTube channel. We're moving on. YouTube channel. So when we get on YouTube, we are streaming live 10:30 service. If you get on there and type in Grace Bible Church Silver Lakes, we've had a lot of people questioning and asking, hey, how do we get your service online? We're not on Facebook. We will put a link on Facebook by Tuesday. Most weeks, a little blurb from the sermon, kind of give a little taster, and then we'll give the link. That way you get on YouTube and type in Grace Bible Church Silver Lakes. I think if you type in something else, you get
it. If you make it a Silver Lake, you get a church in Minnesota. So
there you go.
I mean, they might be good too.
They might be really good, but we'd like it if you checked in with us. So on that note, also subscribe, and then check in on Facebook. It's another thing. So thank you. Service hours starting January 3rd, 2021. We're going to go back to the 9 o'clock service next week and 10:30 service. So good practice. Good job, guys. You guys are here on time. So next slide. Tutors. We're looking for tutors. Are you good at math, algebra 2, or pre-calculus? We have a lot of youth in the high school that are looking for help. They are having to stumble through math that we all had to stumble through, but we had teachers face-to-face. They don't have that anymore. The teachers that are able to get online are, you know, very, very small snippets, and they don't have the ability to ask questions. So what we're looking for is somebody that can answer questions, somebody that's okay with sitting with a kid either on a Zoom profile, one-on-one time, just somebody that's willing to do that. So we're also looking for anybody that can read or write good. We obviously need to find somebody else to write up these slides. So English teachers. So there we go. I got my teachers laughing. So all right. So there we go.
We're good.
Apparently we've got two volunteers already.
I've seen it.
I saw right there. You read and write good. So we're looking for people that you speak and write well. You're welcome. I totally wrote that on purpose. So I don't need the tutor, but we are looking for the tutors for our youth. The youth do need you. Next slide. Small groups.
Well, you go ahead. I was going to say this one.
Oh,
because it's kind of tooting your horn.
Because
you lead the men's group. We're going to start up our small groups again in about 3 weeks, 2 weeks.
Yeah.
It's 2 weeks?
Sure.
Okay. No, we're not?
I have no idea.
Oh, how are you?
That's why it says we'll reconvene after the New Year.
We're taking a break, yeah. But I thought you'd know.
Yeah, no, everybody's taking a break. It's kind of just one of those things. Everybody will get back. We will have, I think, better dates solidified next week for you guys. Mm-hmm. I know the men, we're looking at doing the courageous Bible study. Mm-hmm. So we're going to do we're going to mirror what the MOPS ladies do. They have the ladies.
Maybe don't.
Okay, so I'm just going to hold it for now. Yeah. So we're going to do what the, we're going to mirror what the MOPS do. They have mentor moms. We're looking for mentor dads to look after the dads that have kids still currently. So we're trying to create a relationship, holding men accountable, and there's going to be a whole thing. So I should have a video by next week or the week after talking a little bit more about this for the men's side. So small groups, look for the dates after the new year, and we'll get back to that. So other than that, I think we'll pray for the offering. Yes, ma'am.
Where's the rest of the worship team?
We gave...
They need a week off once a year. So we, traditionally after Christmas, the first weekend, sometimes first two weekends, I just let everybody be off and carry the boats. The tech team doesn't get any off.
No. Yes.
Well, thank you. And so, Olene's back there running the camera. So yeah, we're all just doing our part to help each other out. So nothing's wrong.
So on that note, I did try out, start on the keyboards. Didn't do so well. I hit the drums too hard, and I can't carry a tune even if I had a basket. So, sorry, I would have been a part of the band, but I'm not.
We're working on it.
Moving in the direction of offering. As usual, we'd like to take offering. The things are in the back, but just so you guys know that we are making a difference in the community. Over the last couple weeks, we've the Subaru Spark of Love, we were able to bless 89 kids with gifts. That's from us and from others in just this community alone. We were able to give up some towels to the Victory Outreach, I think that's what they're called. Yeah, the men's group came through, and I think we took over just about shy of 50 to 60 towels. So it was just super awesome. Towels, you wouldn't even think about it, you know, because we have those things. And so through the offering, through your offering, we're able to bless these people nonstop. So I'm going to pray, and we're going to fix this, and we're going to let this go back to Julie. Dear Lord, we thank you for this time. We thank you that we're able to come together and just spend time with you, spend time with other like-minded people. We ask that you bless our offering, allow us to love and care for the people in our community, and bless those that need it the most, Lord. We ask you to bless the rest of this service and allow us to just enjoy our time with you. In your name we pray. Amen.
God rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior was born on Christmas Day to save us all from Satan's power when we had gone astray. Oh, tidings, comfort and joy, comfort and joy. God, our heavenly Father, a blessed angel came, and unto certain shepherds brought tidings of the same. Thou in Bethlehem was born the Son of God by name. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. First verse again. God rest ye merry, gentlemen. And I take that to mean like in peace, knowing who you are in Christ. God rest ye merry, gentlemen. Let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior was born on Christmas Day to save us all from Satan's power when we had gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, oh, tidings of comfort and joy, oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy, oh, tidings of comfort and joy. We praise you, Father. Oh, my goodness. We thank you so much that even in the midst of chaos and things that are just troubling, even things that are just confusing, Lord, we can look to you. Thank you for giving us a family to call our own, that you have, that you're our Abba, you're our Father. I thank you that word even means daddy, because it means so much more than just a child or a father, but a daddy.
You are
Man, that gets me every time I watch it. Anybody else? Yeah? Okay. All right. Good morning, everybody. How are we?
Fine. Good.
Okay, good. Okay, there we go. There's a few people awake in here. Okay. You guys are a lot quieter than first service, and there was less. Okay. So we're gonna have to fix that up. So I woke up this morning, and I was like, I need an introduction on how to talk about the new year. And I was like, you know what, we gotta recap Christmas real quick before we do that. Anybody else feel lighter this time of the year? Weight-wise. Oh, weight-wise, anybody? I feel like I didn't gain my holiday 10. Usually it's a little bit more or less than that, but I feel lighter, like, because we were not going to these parties, we're not going over and being force-fed fudge and, you know, fruitcakes and all that other stuff. Any fruitcake fans in here? Yes, there's one, there's two. I love fruitcakes. You know how many I had this year? Zero. I feel good about that. So, but anyway, I'm feeling lighter on my toes. I hope everybody else is. And we're going to go on a quick guided tour of the Old Testament, Moses in particular. And I promise you, I did my work, my homework, and I didn't make any of this up. So it's going to be fun. But first, before we get there, we've got three types of New Year's people. The cautiously optimistic, they say 8 p.m. is the new midnight. Parents, 8 p.m. is always the new midnight, right? Any excuse to wear sequins? Anybody know where I can get a good sequin shirt for New Year's? No? Jesse? Maybe? Okay. All right, thanks, man. New Year's, save me. The realist, whatever you do, don't ask what's next. Here's hoping that 2020 is really hindsight. Or may the dumpster fire belong to someone else. That one kind of hurts. Famous people obviously weigh in on New Year's. I like the dreams of the future than the history of the past, from Thomas Jefferson. C.S. Lewis says, you are never too old to set another goal or to dream a new dream. My favorite, Charlie Brown. You know how I always dread the whole year? Well, this time, I'm only going to dread one day at a time. So I think that kind of summarizes everything that's kind of happened for us in 2020. I just was talking with Pastor Dave and the staff and just kind of trying to come up with something that we can put together and something that we can look forward to. We've got four more days left in the year. I'm excited about moving out of 2020 into 2021. You know, I was talking about first service that I moved into 2020 thinking, all right, I have bad vision. I wear glasses. Maybe this year I'll be able to see really well. It didn't happen. My vision actually got worse this year. But it's still, it's a year of things that have happened, years that have things have changed, and I think that we've all grown a little bit more from it. So we're going to open our Bibles to Joshua 5. And I'm sorry, I didn't get any notes out last minute, staffing, and I just wasn't able to get to it. So you can forgive me. I will try to have notes next week that'll cover both this week and last week. So we start in Joshua 5, verses 1, and we're going to read all the way through 12. It says, "When all the Amorite kings west of the Jordan and all the Canaanite kings who lived along the Mediterranean coast heard how the Lord had dried up the Jordan River, so the people of Israel could cross, they lost heart and were paralyzed with fear because of them. At that time, the Lord told Joshua, 'Make flint knives and circumcise this second generation of Israelites.' So Joshua made flint knives and circumcised the entire male population of Israel at Gibeath Haraloth. Joshua had to circumcise them because all the men who were old enough to fight in the battle when they left Egypt had died in the wilderness. Those who left Egypt had all been circumcised, but none of those born after the Exodus during the years in the wilderness had been circumcised. The Israelites had traveled in the wilderness for 40 years until all the men were old enough to fight in battle when they left Egypt had died. For they had disobeyed the Lord, and the Lord vowed he would not let them enter the land he had sworn to give us, a land flowing with milk and honey. So Joshua circumcised their sons, those who had grown up to take their father's places, for they had not been circumcised on the way to the promised land. After all the males had been circumcised, they rested in the camp until they were healed. Then the Lord said to Joshua, 'Today I have rolled away the shame of your slavery in Egypt.' So that place has been called Gilgal to this day." Verse 10, "While the Israelites were camped at Gilgal on the plains of Jericho, they celebrated Passover on the evening of the 14th day of the first month. The very next day they began to eat unleavened bread and roasted grain harvested from the land. No manna appeared on the day they first ate from the crops of the land, and it was never seen again. So from that time on, Israelites ate from the crops of Canaan." Lord, we come to you this morning as people looking towards a new year. 2020 has been rough, not just for one or two of us, but for all of us, Lord. We ask that you continue to bless us, keep us safe, and allow the words that come from my mouth be the words that you've put on my heart, and then just let them sink and let them be what it is that you want everybody to understand today, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen. So, we're going to take a step back because Joshua 5 brings up a lot of interesting things. I know it might be a little weird initially to think about, oh, Nick's going to be talking about circumcision. But I promise it will make sense in the end. It's a little weird at first, but we're going to take it back a little bit for the history. We're going to talk about the history of the Israelites, starting with Moses. The Israelites were in bondage to the Egyptians. There's a lot of information here, so I'm just going to recap some of it. Pharaoh commands that all male Israelite children be killed. Moses is born at that time, and Moses' mom, as we all know, was able to take him, put him in a basket, and float him down the Nile. Upon floating him down the Nile, Moses comes to the banks, and Pharaoh's daughter picks up Moses. Falls in love with the baby, calls him Moshe, or Moses, meaning drawn out of the water. She comes out and she says she needs to find a woman, a nursing mother, to take care of the child. Moses' sister Miriam comes along and says, "I have a mom that can do that." And so mom gets to spend time with Moses, even though Moses kind of belongs to Pharaoh. Moses grows up and discovers that he is an Israelite himself. He gets enraged one day with an Egyptian slaver and he kills him, trying to take the matters into his own hands. At this point, this is where Moses runs away. And he runs to the land of Midian, where he lives for 40 years as a shepherd among the people of the Sinai Peninsula. One day on Mount Horeb, Moses encounters a bush that is burning without being consumed by the fire. He hears the voice of God from the bush instructing him to return to Egypt and free his fellow Israelites from slavery. Moses, like many of us, just was struck down by God. He was just in awe of everything that was going on at that moment. And Moses says, God, I understand what you're saying, but I have a problem. I can't speak. When I go to speak, I don't have the words. And God says, that's okay. I will give you your brother Aaron, and your brother Aaron will help you with speaking. So Aaron is tasked to help at that time. Moses comes in and tries to convince Pharaoh to let the people go. And he performs a sign with a staff. Aaron throws a staff on the ground, turns into a serpent. Pharaoh goes, I got you. Come on, guys. And comes over, and the guys do the same thing. But Aaron's staff eats up the other staffs. Well, Pharaoh's not impressed. His heart is hardened, and he says, go away. So the next day, they approach Pharaoh again at the Nile, and then he turns the Nile to blood, turns the water to blood. So Moses approaches Pharaoh on a number of occasions. God does a number of things, all the way up until the point with the climax of killing of the firstborn children. The first Passover was told by God to Moses, get your people, sacrifice a lamb, take the hyssop branches, draw around your doorposts, and the angel of death will pass over from killing your firstborn children. Moses and the Israelites do that, and that night, Pharaoh's son, Ramses II's own son, was killed. And the following day, Ramses says, take your people and go. So Moses takes his people and go. So there we go, moving on. So they move out to the Egyptian wilderness towards the promised land of Canaan. Pharaoh, obviously, we all know this story, has a change of heart and decides to pursue them. The army catches up with them, the Israelites at the Red Sea. But the really cool thing about this is that the Israelites, they didn't have compasses back in the day. They didn't know how to travel. God led them out towards the Red Sea using a pillar of clouds during the day and a pillar of fire at night. When the Israelites are pinched between the Red Sea and the Egyptians, God moves the clouds behind them and the fire at night behind them to protect them so God's people can be protected at that moment in time. Moses is being cried out to by the people, saying, it would have been better for us to stay in Egypt. And the people they're upset, they're murmuring, they're just grouchy, you know, upset with Moses. And Moses stops and he's like, okay. And then he turns to God, he says, God, why? And God says, why? I gave you the power. Use your staff, lift your staff. So Moses goes over to the Red Sea, lifts his staff, and parts the Red Sea. Story we all know and we all love as children that we've read a number of times, but there's small details when you read these stories that when I go back through now and read them as an adult, you kind of pick up on the small things. The example I used in first service is you have a puddle of water and you see the puddle of water and you watch it, you're like, okay, wait till it dries. But you don't walk over that puddle right away, right? Because you might get mud on your shoes. Well, when God parted the Red Sea for Moses, the Israelites walked across the ocean bed on dry ground. Like that. I just blows my mind, just the small details you read these things. And so all the Israelites cross over the Red Sea in Exodus 14, 30 through 31. We see this happen. And as they do that, they get to the other side. The Egyptians follow. And they get to the middle of the ocean, and God lets the waters go and kills all of the Egyptians. So at that moment in time, that is how the Lord rescued Israel from the hand of the Egyptians that day. The Israelites saw the bodies of the Egyptians washed up on the seashore. When the people of Israel saw the mighty power that the Lord had unleashed against the Egyptians, they were filled with awe before him. They put their faith in the Lord and in his servant Moses at that time. I go back and I read that story and I'm just blown away about how awesome it is that God does all of these things. Even looking back at it, you know, from our perspective, knowing how the story ends up, it's still awesome to go back and read these details. I always think, what an adventure. You would think that the people of Israel were truly on board at this time, right? Anybody else agree that God is just 100%? Like, if you saw all of that, there would be no way you'd ever doubt God. Anybody else in the same boat I am? Okay, well, the Israelites were just not at that point in time. So we reach to Numbers 13. And upon their arrival at Kadesh Barnea, which bordered the promised land of Canaan, they sent out 12 spies to survey the land and its people. They returned after 40 days of exploration. 10 of the spies had a bad report. "We can't attack those people," they said. "They are stronger than we are. All the people we saw were of great size. We seemed like grasshoppers in our own eyes." That's Numbers 13, verses 31 through 33. Just for my sake of clarification and for everybody else, just to follow where I'm at, they are on the edge of the promised land. All of everything that's come forward, the generations that were in slavery, the 400 years, the time that they crossed the Red Sea to walking to the edge of the promised land of Canaan, they're right there. And 10 spies say, "We should think twice about this." But we have two spies, Joshua and Caleb, had a different point of view. Believing the report of the 10 doubters, the people lost heart and rebelled. They didn't repel. They raised their voices and wept aloud, grumbling against Moses and Aaron, saying, "If only we had died in Egypt." They are on the edge of promised land, and they're wishing they had died in Egypt. Just stay with me here. "Or in this desert, why is the Lord bringing us to this land only to let us fall by the sword?" Then the Lord said to Moses, "How long will they refuse to believe in me in spite of all the miraculous signs I have performed among them? I will strike them down with a plague and destroy them." Why not? At this point in time, God's like, "I've done everything. I've provided for you. I've released you from bondage. I've led you to the precipice of the promised land, and yet you still doubt." Moses once again interceded for his people and turned away the wrath of God. We turn to Numbers 14, 13 through 20 for this. "Although God did forgive them, he decided that not one of them will ever see the promise land that he promised on the oath to their forefathers. No one who has treated me with contempt will ever see it. Rather, they would suffer by wandering in the wilderness for 40 years. 1 year." This is how all these things start to add up when you read the stories as an adult. 1 year for each of the 40 days they explored the land. God said, "Because you sent in spies and they took 40 days, you're going to get 40 years wishing you were in the promised land." It's amazing how all these things line up. "Furthermore, God would give them what they asked for. 'I will do the very things I heard you say. In this desert, your bodies will fall, every one of you 20 years old or more.' Additionally, the 10 men who had given the bad report were struck down and died of a plague before the Lord." Numbers 14:37. Only Joshua and Caleb had survived out of the spies, the two faithful spies who believed God's promise to give the land over to them. We'll go past that. Desert wandering. Boom. Sorry, let me catch up on this. 40 years later, Moses is dead. Desert has been wandered. Joshua is now in charge, and this is where we pick up the story in Joshua 5. So after the news of Israel's crossing the Jordan River spread, all southern Canaan was in a state of alert awaiting Israel's expected invasion. With Israel's impossible crossing of the Jordan, the Canaanites lost heart and were paralyzed with fear. They know they face the people of God, more powerful than they had worshipped. If we look in here, it says verse 1, "When all the Amorite kings west of the Jordan and all the Canaanite kings who lived along the Mediterranean coast heard how the Lord had dried up the Jordan River so the people of Israel could cross, they lost heart and were paralyzed with fear because of them." I don't know about you, but I've looked up pictures of the Jordan River, modern-day Jordan River, what it looks like now, and it's not that exciting. And I talked about this first service, but then somebody came in and corrected me and said that the reason why this was such a big deal, that these other countries were afraid of the Israelites when they crossed the Jordan River, because the river at that time was in what's known as the flood state. raging waters, rapids, fast-moving water. There was no way that one person could cross the river safely without going downstream miles upon miles. God came to the Israelites and said to Joshua that if your men that are leading the walk, holding the Ark of the Covenant, the minute that their feet goes to touch the water will part. And they did that. They crossed the river. So now that the Israelites have crossed the river, the Nile's at their back, and they're surrounded on other three sides by these other three armies. And these armies are trembling because they realize that their God, the Israelites' God, is more powerful than the ones they worship. Before the Israelites turned their attention to Jericho, God directed Joshua to perform the covenant renewal ceremony of circumcising all the males born in the 40 years since the Exodus from Egypt. In verse 2, we read, "At that time the Lord told Joshua, 'Make flint knives and circumcise the second generation of Israelites.' So Joshua made flint knives and circumcised the entire male population of Israel." Preparations had to be made for this new generation of Israelites going into the promised land. There are four steps that happen. There are four steps that we see the Israelites follow before entering the promised land. We'll only talk about two of them today. We'll save the other two for next week. And the first step that we talk about here is consecration. The action of making or declaring something sacred is a response to God's call and grace. It declares that holiness requires our decision and our response to God. It was not enough that Israel was holy by virtue of being called and chosen. The Israelites had to match this holiness with an act of consecration. Only then was their holiness complete. And only then were they qualified to enter God's holy presence, or in this case, the Holy Land. Romans 12:1 says, "I appeal to you, therefore, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice." Present your bodies as a living sacrifice. I'm going to tie these lines for you here just a second. Follow along, okay? "Holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship." This verse is especially important for several reasons. First, it reminds us that the consecration is a response to God's call and grace. That is the meaning of "therefore" in this verse. We are to present ourselves to God because of all that God has done for us as described in the first 11 chapters of Romans. Secondly, it declares that holiness requires a decision in our response to God. We are to present ourselves. In verse 2, we read that before the Israelites turned their attention to Jericho, God directed Joshua to perform the covenant renewal ceremony of circumcising all the males born in the 40 years since the Exodus from Egypt, because the land was part of the covenant promise. Israel's men needed to demonstrate their personal participation in the covenant through circumcision in order to enter the land. So, here we go. God comes down and tells Joshua, "You have to circumcise all of your men." All of the men previously that came out of Egypt and that were over the age of 20 have already died in the 40 years that they wandered. So all this new generation of men that are alive, that have taken the mantles from their fathers and have led their families, are uncircumcised. And for them, I liken it to being a parent. The parents have raised their children, and we give them everything, and we give them cars, and we give them money, and it's like, wait a second, that's not a good parent. We want to see our parents, or we want to see our children struggle just a little bit, so they kind of get a taste of the real world before we let them go, correct? Israelites had kind of sheltered their children. They didn't get to see the crossing of the Red Sea. They didn't get to see all the things that happened in Egypt and being released from bondage and all the Egyptians and their bodies washing up on the shore. They didn't get to see that. So this generation of Israelite men are living this almost pretend faith. And we have an entire generation of Israelites that are going into the promised land with nothing on the line. Now, forgive me, pardon the pun, They have no skin in the game. Okay? I'll let that sink in for a second. All right, there we go. They have no skin in the game. So they're born Israelites and they're God's chosen people, but they haven't done anything. They haven't proven to God that they accept what God has given them. Flint knives. Let's talk about the flint knives for just a second, okay? They didn't go on Yelp and they look for the best surgeon in the Canaan area. They didn't go online and figure out how to fashion a scalpel from the local metals that they were able to find. No, they grabbed a rock. We all know what flint looks like. And they fashioned a knife from a rock. And we understand that that is a sensitive area for things to be worked on. So that requires pain on behalf of Israelites for them to have skin in the game. So my question to you this morning, along with a few other ones, but my first question to you is, what things do we need to cut off in our lives? What things are going to be the painful things that we have to cut off? Is it our pornography addiction? Is it our alcohol addiction? Is it our Facebook addiction? You know that? Oh, that's not an addiction. Okay, go 45 minutes without looking at your Facebook. Can you hear a ding go off on your phone and not check it for an hour? I'm starting to sweat thinking about it. I don't know if I can do that. You know, do we have those influences of bad people in our life that are leading us down the wrong path? We need to cut them off. There are so many things that we have that in our lives, even as an associate pastor and as people that go to church all the time, we have these battles that we fight. And it's important for us going into the next year to cut these things off. You know, another one that we don't kind of look at is our desire to have the next best thing. You know, I was talking with my brother-in-law, and he has the newest Xbox, and he was like, yeah, he's like, but in 6 months, the newest Xbox is releasing, and I'm getting that. And I'm just like, I love you to death, and I understand, but is that necessary? Is that something that we can give up, that we can cut off and move on? The next step we have is confirmation. Since God inflicted the pain, God must bring about the healing. They just got circumcised. All of the fighting age, the fighting capable men were circumcised at the same moment. How do you go to war when you can't walk? You know, I've been to Iraq, I've been to Afghanistan, and I almost chopped off this finger. I was goofing around with the guys, and I almost chopped off this finger. And I tell you what, I don't need my finger to do my job, but I need my finger to sleep because it hurt so bad. And it's like, you know, every little task, every deep breath hurts when you have something that's not right with you. How you dodge swords and spears, but you can hardly take a deep breath, right? These guys have just had surgery, and they're surrounded by people that want to kill them. They look to God to bring about the healing. They knew that God would protect them in their time that they were healing. That's just, to me, it just blows my mind. You know, if you were to say, Nick, you're going to go to combat, and you're going to be circumcised in the middle of combat. You okay with that? I don't think I could do that. To be useful to God. Stop it. I'm sorry. To be useful to God, you have to go through some pain. Amen? Amen? Okay. So, I'm sorry. I'm going to burst somebody's bubble. If your New Year's resolution is to grow deeper in your faith with God, there's pain in your forecast. I'm sorry. As I am standing here talking with all of you and to all of you online, it is going to happen. You are going to struggle with something. You are going to lose something. You are going to get hurt by somebody you love. You're going to fall off a dirt bike and break a rib. Something is going to happen. But you have to rely and lean on God to bring about the healing. Confirmation comes from God in that the scars that are left behind are signs that we've been healed. You know, I look at the scar on my hand, and it's my kids always talk about, you know, Dad, tell us a story when you were at war, and tell me this or tell me that. And, you know, the questions you get from the random people, like, have you ever killed somebody? No, I've never killed anybody. And it's funny because I look at this scar and I laugh because I got this in combat, but I don't have a cool story. I've got I was an idiot story. But it's a scar that reminded me, that reminds me to this day that I missed the first 18 months of my daughter's life. And you know, even talking about it, I still feel the little tinge because I went and talked to the doctor and they said, you were like a half a millimeter away from severing the tendon and never being able to use your pointer finger ever again. And so I look at that scar and I remember being away from my daughter for 18 months and coming back from war and seeing a toddler who's walking and talking, and I'm like, you know, you're gone for a year at a time and you don't remember what little people are like. You're used to dealing with adults and other men mostly, and you're just like, ah, whatever, man. But you see a kid and you're like, you're scared at first, I'll be honest with you. But I look at this scar and I remember, and to this day, I have worked so hard to make that relationship with my daughter better. I love spending the time with her, but it's the scars that help us be better. It helps us heal. It helps us be better for God in the long run. Do we have any scars from 2020? There's a couple people back there. Mark might have like 6 or 7 of them, right, Mark? All right, man. Love you, Mark. God had promised them victory. The land he commanded them to go in and take was already theirs. They simply had to trust and obey. But this, they did not do. God will never lead us where his grace cannot provide for us or his power cannot protect us. Indeed, the Israelites had seen the powerful hand of God at work during the plagues and miracles of the Exodus. Yet, like many people, they walked by sight and not by faith. And their unbelief displeased God. Without faith, it is impossible to please God, Hebrews 11:6. Their failure to believe in God's word kept them from entering the promised land. And this truth, ladies and gentlemen, today has never changed. We had a generation of Israelite men who were going to fight and come into the promised land for the first time, but they didn't know what it was like to have that open relationship with God. They didn't witness Moses parting the Red Sea and bringing water from a rock and God raining manna down from the sky. And, you know, there's a portion in there that talks about that the people were grumbling so bad that they're like, oh, we're tired of eating the bread. We're tired of eating the bread, that God gave them quail. They had so much quail that it had it coming out of their noses. It's black and white, ladies and gentlemen. These are the things that we need to do moving into 2021. So what are you going to do for God as you prepare to head into 2021? You know, what things do you need to cut off in your life? You know, I stand here and as a human being, I have things that I need to cut off. I have things I know that are under attack constantly by the enemy. I know that my relationship with my wife is the number one thing. And I work really hard every day to make sure that doesn't fall victim. Are you going to succeed in 2021 with your 2020 mindset? You know, I was laughing and I was talking with Fred Harris before the first service, and I asked him this question. He laughed. He's like, I'm looking at using the 2019 mentality going into 2021. And I started laughing. I was like, you know, but it's important that we try to have a better outlook, to be look back on the things that happened to us in 2020 and realize that we've been hurt, a lot of us on a deeper scale than others. We've lost a lot of people. We've lost a lot of things. We've lost a lot of privileges as Americans and Californians. But it's the things that make us look to God and say, you have a plan. You're greater than all of the shenanigans that are going on, and it's important. So what needs to be cut away in your life? What things do we need to give up to grow closer to God? So I'll go ahead and pray. Lord, thank you for this time. We thank you that you've given us a roadmap, and there are places on this map, Lord, that we know is difficult. It's going to be difficult for us. But we know that you're there to heal us, to love us, to guide us from point A to point B, Lord. We ask that you watch over everybody as they move into 2021. Four more days left in 2020, Lord. We ask that you just bless these last 4 days. Let us make the biggest impact that we can and prepare our hearts and souls mentally for 2021. We ask that you continue to bless those that are sick, bless those that are homeless, and we ask you to watch out over the veterans, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds kept their watching o'er silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens there shone a holy light. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. The shepherds feared and trembled when low above the earth rang out the angel chorus that hailed our Savior's birth. Go tell it on the mountains, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Christmas morn. Go tell it on the mountains, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born, that Jesus Christ is born, that Jesus Christ is born.
All right.
Yeah, that's our call, to go tell it on a mountain, or stand out in the desert and tell it, or go next door to the market and tell it. But we've got to tell them who Christ is, and he's here, and he gives us hope. So take that with you for this week and into our new year. Hope to see you next week. If you're online watching, we just hope that you can keep tuning into that. Every once in a while, we have a little technical glitch, but I know we know you're out there. So send in your prayer requests, and we'll see you then. See you next week.